Not the dark, but the light
of the silvery moon.
Not
the
Gee, I think that Doris Day is terrific.
Well, thank you.
This week, a fond farewell to Doris Day, plus a startling sci-fi movie from Sweden. Revisiting Woodstock 50 years later, and I sit down with the unique actor Crispin Glover to talk about his new thriller, We Have Always Lived in the Castle. I'm Bill Newcott, film critic for the Saturday Evening Post. All that on our video podcast, Movies for the Rest of Us. You wouldn't expect the year's most visually stunning and emotionally absorbing science fiction film to come from Sweden. But get a load of Aniara, the story of a cruise ship-sized interplanetary craft lost in space. The time is the relatively near future, and Earth has become so inhospitable that humanity is now migrating to Mars. But a deep space mishap sends the ship, called Aniara, tumbling into the cosmos. For the rest of their lives, this will be the only home these humans ever have. Emily Johnson is endearing as a ship crew member who tries to roll with the punches fate throws her way. And the film's graphic depictions of a society first building itself up, then tearing itself apart, is a grim reminder of the ways we interact with each other on our own spaceship, the one we call Earth.
My name is Mary Catherine Blackwood. The Blackwoods have always lived in this house. And we will never leave here, no matter what they say or what they do to us. Never.
Back in elementary school, most of us read a chilling short story called The Lottery, written by Shirley Jackson. The creepy, confounding new thriller, We Have Always Lived in the Castle, is based on a novel by Jackson, who also wrote The Haunting of Hill House. There aren't any ghosts in We Have Always Lived in the Castle, but there are plenty of haunted people. Especially two sisters, played by Alexandra Daddario and Thaisa Farmiga, whose parents were poisoned at a dinner party several years earlier. The girls survived, as did their uncle Julian, who is nevertheless slipping into paranoid dementia, probably due to the arsenic he ingested during the murders.
My niece, Constance, could tell you of the most unlikely of perils. Garden plants, more deadly than snakes, and simple herbs that slash like knives through the lining of your belly, madam.
It's all been forgotten.
Julian is played by the always interesting Crispin Glover, who ever since co-starring as George McFly in Back to the Future has played dozens of off-kilter, often quietly menacing characters.
Hey, what do you let those boys push you around like that for?
Well, they're bigger than me.
Hi.
Hi, Crispin. How are you?
Good. How are you doing?
I'm doing very well. You're one of those distinctive screen actors. I think people like you and Christopher Walken and Michael Keaton, when an actor like you turns up, audience says to itself, okay, this is going to get interesting.
My niece was acquitted of murder, madam. There could be no possible danger in visiting here now. Julian Blackwood.
Hello, Lucille.
We Have Always Lived in the Castle is one of those films. You play this off-center guy. But as off-center and strange as this character is and other characters you play, you have to keep that character accessible to an audience so the audience isn't turned off by you.
One of the things I was attracted to for the character was the character archetype of this is the mentor character. An obvious example of the mentor character would be Obi-Wan Kenobi in Star Wars.
This is the weapon of a Jedi Knight. Not as clumsy or random as a blaster.
And it's an interesting play on it because the character literally has dementia. I often am cast as the antagonist, which is fine. It's a good character for me to play.
But in a film where you are the antagonist, you've still got to connect with the audience on some level, right?
Well, I'm not sure if that's true, because a structural antagonist can almost be a non-entity. You could have a structural antagonist that's a rock. That rock may not do much other than be an immovable force that the protagonist has to deal with.
Do you think you think about acting more than most actors?
I don't know. I don't know about that. I assume most actors think about what they're doing. You have to memorize the lines at the very least. I mean, my nature is toward being an analytical person. But like I say, it depends on the role. Some roles, it's almost harmful to have an actor in it. It's better to have a non-actor sometimes.
That chair is my dead brother's chair.
The stylish and intriguing We Have Always Lived in the Castle is in theaters and on video on demand.
The world is full of terrible people.
We started to hear rumors that this thing was more or less out of hand because no one knew the amount of tickets that were sold.
The definitive performance film about Woodstock remains Michael Wadley's Oscar-winning 1970 documentary. But on the 50th anniversary of the Mammoth Concert in upstate New York, a new documentary explores how the concert happened, what went right, what went wrong, and what it all means. The title is a mouthful, but Woodstock, 3 days that defined a generation, delivers on its promise to help us see that there was a lot more to that rainy weekend than just the music.
The outside world thought it was a disaster area. Well, that's not what we thought.
You sigh, the song begins, you speak.
At age 26, Doris Day had already been singing with big bands for 9 years when she landed her first movie role in Romance on the High Seas. Jack Carson fell in love with her in that film, and so did movie audiences. In just a couple of years, Doris's name was appearing above the titles of all her films. Doris's film career was surprisingly short, barely 20 years of big screen movies, and although we like to think we know exactly what a Doris Day movie was, she was surprisingly willing to take chances.
You like to be a dirty butcher?
Okay.
Be a dirty butcher!
Hey, what? You've gone crazy. Are you out of your mind? What have you got against him? What has he done to you? Why?
Julie, you're going to die.
How did you find me?
Darling, you can't get away from me.
No matter what. Well, you're insane.
Maybe.
Mrs. Preston, over here now, Mrs. Preston.
Who are you?
You'll know just before I kill you.
When in my heart I know.
Doris Day made her last movie in 1968. More than 50 years later, the outpouring of love following her death at age 97 proved one thing beyond a doubt. She never stopped being America's sweetheart.
$0.10 a dance, that's what they pay me. Gosh, how they weigh me down. $0.10 a dance, dandies and rough guys, tough guys who tear my gown. 7 to midnight.